Our Bahamas field course is something that we really hope our students get a lot out of. This field course incorporates a real mixture of activities, and I think that's really important because a career in conservation requires quite a mixture of activities. My name is Dr. Lucy Hawkes. I'm a lecturer in ecology at the University of Exeter. One day our students might be out in the beautiful Bahamian waters you can see behind me, and they might be catching sea turtles, putting tags on them and doing things that are really quite thrilling. But another day they might be working on that data and analysing it to derive things like abundance of fish, diversity of fish on different reefs that they can compare between years, between patches of reefs. And that really reflects what it's like to work in the real conservation sector.
The wide range of topics that we teach on the course ensures that when students leave here, they understand the whole tropical ecosystem, not just small components, but how all of the bits of it interlink together, how they function, and what the consequences are if we manage them inappropriately. I'm Dr. Matthew Witt. I work for the University of Exeter for their Environment and Sustainability Institute at the Cornwall campus. I mostly enjoy teaching components of field skills on the course. It enables me to take the students out to show them how to handle wild animals, work in real habitats, so that it builds their confidence and also their skill sets. Students should pick the Bahamas field course because of the wide range of activities that we do. We take people out on boats, we take them diving, they go snorkeling, and it's that wide range of activities and the wide range of habitats and the diverse nature of all the species we see that makes our course truly experiential. So on Reef Day, we take our students out to the local reefs. This is such a great place for that. We have such a diversity of reef types here. We have reefs near shore, we have offshore reefs, we have reefs that drop down into the deep sea, down to 700, 800 and 1,000 metres. And that allows us to drive an understanding in the students about the variation, the types of fish we see, what these different types of reefs deliver to the ecosystems. We'll go out and measure fish diversity and train them in agri-techniques to understand corals. The Reef Day is great. All of the students come back having learned so many fish species, and seeing that learning in them is really fantastic.
At the Cape Eleuthera Institute here, we have an entire day where we look at stingrays here in the Caribbean. We're really fortunate here to be able to work with Dr. Owen O'Shea, who is currently the head of the Ray and Shark Research Program here. And it turns out that comparatively little is known about stingrays in this area. And Dr. O'Shea has a really exciting research program capturing both southern stingrays as well as Caribbean whiptail rays.
I've been running this research for 2 years. It's the largest, most comprehensive assessment of stingray ecology and biology that's ever taken place in the Bahamas. My name's Owen, Dr. Owen O'Shea. I am the principal research scientist here. I run all the shark and ray stuff, and this is Casey Sullivan, who it's her first day back today. She is a research technician that works with the program, but is a dedicated stingray specialist as well, so she'll be supporting us today. What we're going to do is drive about a mile away from here, find a beach, and we're going to mince around in the flat and then come down. We have two species that aggregate here as well, which is quite unusual because one of these species we only discovered a couple of years ago. What we do need to discuss though is how we're going to catch these animals, okay, and what we're looking for. Because if somebody gets stung, there's no hospital on this island, and it is by far the most painful thing you will experience. We need to be very mindful of these creatures today. They are wild animals. We do not domesticate them. We don't feed them at all. They are completely 100% wild. While they're relatively docile, they are equipped to defend themselves by any means necessary. What we're going to be doing is walking in a line perpendicular to the beach. Okay, Casey will be one of the net operators. Somebody will be on the other end of the net with her. We have a seine net. It's a white seine net that you unfurl, okay? And the name of the game is to get the ray in the net. We're going to be forming a circle like we are now with the ray in the middle, and we're going to be herding into this white net. There are two species that we might encounter today. One is the southern stingray, and the second one is the Caribbean whiptail stingray. Southern stingrays are dark, diamond-shaped animals. The other species is the Caribbean whiptail stingray. This is a new species to the Bahamas. It doesn't formally exist on paper. I'm about to have a paper published this month that details its contemporary distribution, which now includes the Bahamas Islands. We need to treat these animals with respect, not only because they're dangerous, but they're also wild animals, and it needs to be put back in the environment in as close a condition as possible as to what it was when we caught it. While we study stingrays, our true mission is as conservation biologists. We're interested in how we can provide frameworks for management and conservation of coastal nearshore habitats, which in this country are very vulnerable due to, you know, degradation by human-induced activities, cruise ship terminals, building hotels, dredging mangroves, etc., etc. So stingrays are merely a mechanism with which we use to try and understand these processes, these coastal processes.
Bahamas offers lots of lovely shallow warm waters, and so it's a really nice nursery ground for juvenile sea turtles, in particular green sea turtles. Our students head out on a boat and we all search frantically from the surface to look if we can see a sea turtle, and they're quite obvious because you see a dark shape jetting through the water. We follow the turtle until it gets into some shallow water, and then the students, one at a time, jump in with their mask and snorkel, and they swim as fast as they can after the sea turtle, and then when they catch up with it, they grab it gently under the armpits, lift it out of the water, and then we come along with the boat and pick the turtle up and put it onto the boat. She's going to get it this time, she's going to get it. Yes! Massive, massive prize from Megan. Immensely strong. When we get the turtles on the boat, we then measure the turtles, we attach identification tags to them, and sometimes some small samples may be taken from the turtles by the research institute here. That might include samples for genetic analysis, maybe aging turtles, maybe looking at markers of diet while they're here feeding in their nursery grounds. And all of this data is really useful. Scientific papers are being published on sea turtles here in the Bahamas based on the data that our students are helping to collect. We have another whole day here just dedicated to sharks of the Bahamas. On these days, we do something called experimental longlining. So here we use the same fisheries practice that's used commercially to catch fish for consumption. But this way we're doing it in a much kinder fashion, and we want to maintain the health of these animals all the way through capture and then release the animals in a healthy state at the end. So to do this, we use a very special sort of a hook called a circle hook. And we bait the hook with very oily fish. We use things like mackerel or tuna. And we set these long lines. So this is a long line with many hooks on it. And we set that in the waters out here. We then pour in a load of horrible fish slop, and hopefully the sharks smell this and come into our lines. The lines themselves have a timer on, so that as soon as the shark takes the bait, it pulls the timer, and we know exactly how long the shark has been on that hook for. We check the lines and the hooks very, very regularly to ensure that the sharks are taken off of the hooks as soon as possible. And immediately when we have a shark, we detach the shark from the rest of the long line setup. We bring the shark up alongside the boat, and that's when we can begin to collect data. We collect data by retaining the bait and the hook in the shark's mouth, but then we put a rope around its tail and attach that to the boat. Sharks do a really special thing called tonic immobility. If you turn a shark upside down, so its belly is facing upwards, they kind of become hypnotized. And this is a really ideal way to be able to keep these sharks just long enough that we can attach an identification tag to them and to measure them before releasing them in a really healthy state. So this is some really exciting research, and it's so thrilling for our students to be able to see something that really not very many people in the world get to see.
I'm incredibly passionate about this course. It gives the students such a deep grounding in working in the wild, seeing these habitats. In the UK, we don't have tropical habitats available to us. And so the Cape Eleuthera Institute and the Island School, where we bring them, offers such an experience for the students. You learn so much here and the staff are so passionate about their work.
Overall, the Bahamas Field Course provides our students not just with the opportunity to be in this unbelievably gorgeous place, but also to see these really amazing habitats and to get really up close and personal with some really charismatic, amazing animals that live in them. By the end of our field course, our students leave with a set of skills, learning how to conduct standard surveys by accord with international protocols that can be useful in their future careers. They know how to handle animals, they know how to work in teams, they know how to work in demanding and stressful environments. But I like to hope that all of our students really personally gain something out of this as well. Some of the stuff we ask our students to do can be tiring, it can be stressful, and it can be quite demanding. And every year we typically see students that really perhaps start to operate slightly outside of their comfort zone, and you can really see the rewards they get from that. And we like to hope that we return our students not just with a greater set of skills and experience and a little bit of a suntan, but also with a lot more personal self-esteem as a consequence of what they've been doing. And that gives me a great deal of reward, really, for teaching this course, and that's why we come here.